Two common approaches to fMRI analysis are voxel-wise encoding models and representational similarity analysis. The results from these two approaches are often framed in different ways. For example, encoding models are often said to estimate voxel tuning to different features. In contrast, RSA is said to capture the representational geometry of the brain. So this raises the question, is there a fundamental relationship between these two methods? Do encoding model weights reflect the representational geometry of the brain? And could RSA be used to predict encoding model performance? To investigate these questions, we use the K-natural image dataset, which contains nearly 2,000 naturalistic images, as well as fMRI responses to each image for a single subject. To fit an encoding model, first we created a set of low-level visual features for each stimulus. This was done by generating a range of different Gabor filters and applying them to each image. Additionally, we hand-generated multiple semantic labels for each image, describing the objects and scene features as seen here. We then applied regularized linear regression to our semantic features and the fMRI brain responses to fit a matrix of model weights. In total, we generated three models, one using each set of stimulus features, and a third model using both Gabor and semantic features together. Finally, we used the resulting model weights to predict brain responses to each of the stimuli in the validation set, with the correlation between the predicted and recorded brain responses in each voxel serving as a metric of prediction accuracy. As you can see here, our Gabor features predicted well in a decent number of voxels, and while the semantic model performed comparatively worse, there are still a number of voxels that seem to be predicted above chance. And here we have the same result but split into ROIs. Our Gabor model performed much better in early visual areas, whereas our semantic model performed much better in more anterior visual areas, in line with the well-accepted hierarchical structure of visual cortex. Next, we use the same models to perform a type of decoding known as stimulus identification. The data provided to us contain voxel responses to each validation image, and as mentioned previously, our encoding model also yields predicted voxel responses to each image. By comparing each set of true responses to all of the predicted responses, we're able to infer which stimulus image most likely caused each volume of activity. Here we have bar plots of the percent of images that were correctly identified for each of our models. As you can see here, our best model, which used both Gabor and semantic features, was able to correctly identify the original stimulus over 64% of the time, suggesting this model has a robust ability to infer stimulus identity from brain activity. And here we have some examples of incorrectly decoded images, revealing that images that are incorrectly identified still tend to have high visual similarity to the true stimulus images. In addition to our encoding models, we also applied RSA to the data. Thus, we generated an RDM based on measured brain data, as seen here, and for each of the sets of features, as seen here. We then computed the correlation between each of the feature RDMs and the RDM of the brain to determine the extent to which each set of features effectively captured the information represented in the brain. Here on the left, we have bar plots displaying that correlation metric. All of the feature RDMs capture some non-zero degree of the representational geometry of the brain, and on the right, we have the bar plots from previously. And the similarity between relative decoding performance and relative feature brain RDM correlations suggests a potential relationship between these two metrics. So we've now related the decoding performance to the brain's representational geometry, but we still haven't addressed specifically whether the weights of our model reflect the extent to which a specific stimulus feature is represented in the brain. To this end, we generated simplified versions of each of our sets of features. We averaged our Gabor features in different regions of the visual field, as seen here. Similarly, we used our semantic labels and the word.net hierarchy to extract 32 different high-level semantic features, which were present in at least 10% of the training images, as seen here. As before, we fit a unique encoding model for each of the two new sets of features, as well as the third model incorporating both sets together. We also computed RDMs for each of the 66 new Gabor and semantic features, as you can see here. We computed the correlations between each feature RDM and the RDM for the entire brain, resulting in a quantitative metric of the extent to which each of these new features was represented in the brain. As demonstrated by the correlation of 0.86 between the RSA-derived metrics and the average encoding model weights for these features, encoding model weights indeed seem to be a clear reflection of the representational geometry of the brain. Finally, to determine whether we could actually predict decoding model performance using RSA, we applied multidimensional scaling to the RDMs for our features, revealing the clusters and dissimilarities between the stimuli. The results of our poorly performing semantic feature set show no clear distinction between correctly and incorrectly decoded images. But if we look at the results for our Gabor features, we see a relatively striking difference between images based on decoding results. And actually, if we add in our semantic features as well, we see an even clearer difference, as seen here. We fit a support vector classifier to these RDM results, and as you can see in here, these do a relatively good job for the two sets containing Gabor features, suggesting that feature RDMs could be used to predict decoding performance for new individual stimuli. To conclude, both encoding models and RSA can not only be used to perform a number of different interesting analyses, but analyses can be directly and quantitatively related between these two approaches, suggesting that voxel-wise encoding models and RSA are in many ways investigating the same underlying information about the brain. I'd like to give thanks to our mentor, Ala Ahmed, our TA Michael Wascom and the Neuromatch organizers, and to you for watching.